Every week, a new band. Brought to you by NZ On Air.
Active Life! Yeah.
Thank you. chills. Kia ora koutou katoa, kei te whakaronga mai koe ki te Radioactive FM and today's Active Live session made with support from New Zealand On Air. I'm Amidia and we are joined live in studio by none other than Milktooth. Kia ora.
Kia ora.
How's it going?
Good.
Very good.
Yes, the sun is out. We are happy.
Yeah, it's a beautifully magnetic energy in the room today. Would you like to introduce yourself?
I'm Leanne.
I'm Stella.
I'm Eve.
I'm Eli.
This is Eli on the drums.
I'm Estelle over here as well.
We're very excited to have you all in today. Now, Just Playing was, of course, your single released a little over a month ago, Liquid, the first track to have out for people to listen to on the streaming services and stuff. What's the reception of that been like?
It's been really amazing. I feel like it's been very cool looking at the Spotify stats and seeing people in countries so far away have given a listen, which is really cool. And it's just felt like a lot of warmth and support from Poneki, especially. So it's been
people singing the lyrics.
People singing the lyrics at our shows, which is kind of an insane feeling.
That's beautiful. Because you guys sort of found your footing in the Poneke music scene playing mostly live, is that correct? How did you find that initial period of sort of existing but not having content to direct people to?
I kind of found it really nice, to be honest. It was more just in the moment and just directing people to see us live first, just to see our essence, in person rather than us as a online presence,
And every song could be a different version each time.
I feel like if we had released something a lot earlier, it might have felt a little restricting. I think we were very much the first year of gigging, we were very much trying to, well, not finding a sound, but experimenting a lot, and it kind of felt nice to have the freedom to be it doesn't matter if we don't play something or if we do play something, but it's also very nice to have something to direct people to now.
That sort of development, is that something you'd see continuing with future music, or do you feel more sort of settled now in what you've got going on?
No.
No way, we're doing all of the genres.
All of the genres.
One genre per week.
Songs every week.
Yeah.
You've been described as a divine soundscape that sort of binds you.
That's a very flattering comment.
I think I wrote that.
How did Milktooth come about?
We all kind of came together through Messy, just from our unanimous feelings of being kind of the minority in our classes, and we all kind of had, I don't know, similar experiences. We came together as a group project for our second year of uni.
I remember the first time we kind of met up, I didn't really know Stella and Estelle very well at all. And I just remember we sat in a room to try and talk about what we wanted our project to be. And we were in there for probably almost 2 hours just talking and talking and talking. So it kind of felt nice to, find your people and be oh, this is what the music industry can be.
I feel the energy of that room when we all came about, we were just so excited.
Yeah.
We all kind of aligned.
Yeah.
From the get-go.
And so magical that we've all found each other as well, because we're all perfect together.
Beautiful pieces of a puzzle.
Yeah. Divine.
Yeah. I think the first jam we had together was just so there wasn't really any, awkwardness at all, which is sometimes that just happens when you jam with people for the first time, but it was just we just started making a song. We're cool, we'll just go from here.
Yeah, free flowing.
And make one song for 20 minutes.
So this isn't a typical blend of instruments that we've got in the room for a band, so to speak. How did you find the balance of sound, and was it your the instrument first, or did it sort of come from your goal? How did the skills develop that you've got in the room?
Yeah, We kind of like...
We our first set we ever did was us imagining like a post-apocalyptic world, and we all had our own characters and just played around with different sounds from that, and it kind of grew and grew, and the equipment that we use has grown as well.
Every like few months this show gets a new keyboard.
I know. Next time we come in here I'm going to be surrounded completely.
But I think we all kind of, we really all appreciate electronic music a lot. Like I remember Estelle was like really the pioneer of that, because you listen to quite like hardcore techno. And like just being like, okay, we're going to make like club music, but make it live. And so I think like we all had different inspirations that we pulled from.
Yeah, we all come from different genres.
Yeah, but we kind of found the link between them all. But I think, like, we're just all synth lovers. So
I think we're very open-minded in the way we create as well.
Yeah.
And I feel like with electronic, like, having two laptops, you can create, as any sounds that you want to make, like, live and on studio as well.
Yeah. I think, like, the weirder something sounds to us, the more we like it. Like, often our songs will just start with, like, I don't know, someone, like, making a really strange noise on their synth, and then we're like, cool, let's just jam. Which is fun, yeah.
Awesome. Well, would you like to play another song for us?
Yeah. This one's called Voyager.
Thank you. Can you hear me?
Hokumaiki to Active Live with Milktooth. That was beautiful.
Thank you.
You mentioned earlier, or we were talking about how you each bring different genres and musical backgrounds to creating your sound. What does that process actually look like? Like, does one person bring a lyric or a something like that? How do you balance with five people?
We kind of do it all at once, really.
Yeah, it all just happens.
Yeah, I feel like it can be chaotic and it can be beautiful at the same time. But we usually, like Eve said, one of us would be playing a sound, or Estelle would be playing like a nice little thing on her three synths, and we would just go along with it, and then we kind of just like repeat it and see how it naturally progresses.
We're all telepathically connected, so it kind of just happens quite easily.
Yeah. I think, like, we also, when something's kind of, like, starting to form, like, you know, someone will be like, hey, I'm, like, really inspired by this song at the moment or this artist, like, and they do, like, they kind of have this build-up, or there's, like, this kind of element where, like, a key changes or the feeling changes. Like, can we try and bring that in a way? Or, you know, we share music within our group chat. And kind of like, can we make something like this? Just like this, but different. Yeah. But it kind of, it's quite chaotic. Kind of happens at once, I think.
That was literally my next question. I'm about the kind of, what's the soundtrack behind your music that you guys have in your ears when you're creating?
I don't know. Our first ever set was completely through composed. So we just had like a 40-minute set of technically one song, and that flowed through, like, it was a complete journey from like ambient, ethereal to like, yeah, in the post-apocalyptic world. Yeah, and to like...
We try to bring pure expression.
Trying to relay what Eli said.
But yeah, I feel like we have a lot of, you know, we each have our different influences kind of going on in our head, and I know when I'm adding, because often I'm just adding little bits and pieces with the guitar, I'll be inspired by like this album or this album, and kind of like try and take parts of that and emulate it if I can, or just be inspired by it, not copy it.
Obviously not. Speaking of that sort of having an ambient just journey as your set, versus making individual tracks with sort of like a streaming or an output ability, have you found that to be conflicting with like what you're wanting to do, or is it
definitely
sort of?
I think the dream, our initial dream, I don't know what the dream is
still
now,
our dream.
Is to like kind of have an album that, because our first set, that our set now is kind of like broken up in places, but the first set we did was, there was no stopping for half an hour, and it would be like amazing to make an album that could be through composed like that, and every song blends into the other, but time to do that is hard to find, but yeah
we were talking about it last night actually, just how crazy it is that we have a set list now, like we have to have a set list for each gig now, because we've kind of like had it down now, like our, like the transitions to each song
had to conform,
and we definitely want to bring it back where we don't have a set list.
Speaking of that sort of creating a set list, recently you guys have created some little bits and bobs with Awkward Talks. How did that segment come about? Tell me about it.
Eli is flatmates with Kay, who is half of Awkward Talks. I think he's had a chat with them about it. They're two very awesome people. I think it's like a really important like thing to be able to talk about, you know, things that aren't often talked about, like how do you like ask someone for money for doing something, or like how you can feel really like actually just really anxious during a gig and it's not all good. It's like a really cool thing to talk about, I think. I think it like adds a degree of like relatability for people to watch us just kind of like being slightly camera shy and awkward,
like running around, like the reality of
being very late to things,
tooth rituals.
How did you feel sort of drawing that curtain and bringing the public into that almost sacred space behind the stage and in your little get ready zone?
I think it's kind of nice. Yeah, I feel like it's good to show everybody what we do, plus we're all open books here.
It was, honestly, I found it kind of hard to know what to say at first. Someone's, you know, it's like talking about yourself is hard, and like talking about the process of doing something is like really hard because a lot of it's unconscious, and it's like, oh, how do I feel before the gig? But it was really cool, it's nice to be vulnerable, I think.
Did anything sort of shock you when you were being asked those questions that you hadn't realized before?
I think there was this one question that really was like, I think it was like the really nice question about like, what do you appreciate about yourself?
Yeah, you find it really hard to answer that.
I don't know, because that's like just...
Yeah.
because it was like kind of like put on the spot, and it's like before a gig, we don't really have the time to think about like how we're feeling. We kind of just like, especially if we're like, on a time crunch, or like we have work before or something like that. Like, it's like kind of hard to just vocalize that to other people as well.
It's like such like an important thing that like you don't think to do very much is like, what am I gonna be good at? Instead of thinking about, I hope I don't mess this up. Like what am I excited to do right? Because I know I'm gonna get some things right, and you never kind of think about the positive side. I often don't if I'm like, for a gig.
So it's kind of like a learning that you got from the experience.
Just to try and be more compassionate towards ourselves.
Is that going to be part of your pre-gig sort of prep now?
I think we should. Maybe,
yeah. Bring it to tomorrow night.
We always do a breathing circle as well together.
Yeah, I noticed that before you started.
Yeah, we didn't get to hug this time.
We usually like to huddle like in a circle and we...
Take deep breaths
together. It's very like grounding, and it I think it also helps the performance because you feel more connected to the people you're playing with.
More telepathically inclined.
Beautiful. Well, would you like to play your next song for us?
Yeah.
If you're feeling ready for it.
What is
this? This is a we've been doing this track probably since we started. Thank you.
dancing with your eyes. Do you think I'm selfish? Do you think I'm kind? Envious of what I had. Envious of what I can be. So I think it's time that we settle this. Once and for all.
To Active Live here with Milktooth live in studio. So tomorrow's a big day. You've got a music video coming out.
Yeah.
The little snippets I've seen of it looks absolutely musical and magical. Tell me about the development of that video.
We worked with Taylor Nixon, who's been doing a lot of stuff in the scene lately. He's a really awesome guy. Yeah, and we kind of like, there was a lot of pre-planning, trying to get the vision right, but we kind of wanted something quite like unsettling, kind of like morphs from like, kind of like very spaced out, weird, unsettling beach and kind of goes into something a bit more crazy towards the end. But just, it was really fun.
So fun.
Was yeah. The process of that was kind of like, I feel like after like the first day of shooting that, I kind of like stepped like out of myself and just like what happened during that day, because we were all just like kind of performing, really. Yeah. It's like a performance, like to be in front of
it's kind of the ultimate performance. Yeah. Like, it's kind of cool to put on a persona in that way and then just be like, that's not me, but it's me.
Yeah, because was that your first experience making a music video?
Yeah, Estelle's made one before with Taylor as well.
Mm.
But I think as a group, our first experience. Mm.
Yeah, it's kind of strange seeing yourself like... I always used to think about what it would feel like to be like a famous actor and then like going to the premiere and seeing yourself and how weird that must be. So it's kind of like a bit of like, oh my goodness, that's me.
Yeah, listening to your recorded voice, but like on steroids.
Yeah, for sure. But no, it's a very fun thing to do. It's cool to put visuals to something kind of like, I guess like when someone's just hearing music, they can kind of take whatever they want from it, and then you kind of almost control it in a way by putting mm-hmm. visuals to it. And it's like, this is what we were thinking. So it's cool.
Yeah, do you think that your image and sort of like, I mean, I haven't seen the full music video, but I know the song, will they line up as you expect? Or do you think you kind of gave it a whole nother story by creating that?
I think the story has changed a bit since we made the music video, definitely. Yeah. Or we've thought about what the song means differently since then.
I think like, you know, as like people, our moods and like perceptions of things are ever changing, so it's hard to like you know, it's like writing in your journal and being like, this is the way I'm always going to feel about my thought then, and it's like, it's definitely not the way, but it was cool to like capture how we were feeling at the time of filming, you know. Yeah, it's a visualizer. Yeah.
And are there more music videos, recordings coming out for Milk Tea?
Yeah, we've got our next single coming out in October. Hopefully it's the one you just heard, Voyager.
Oh, not just heard. It's the second one. That was really cool. We've been recording with Dave Carter, who was one of the tutors at Massey. And he's just like, he's so awesome. I feel like we got into the studio for recording Voyager and we were like, this is what we have. I don't know if this is what we want to do with it. And then he's got such like a good vision for making things really weird.
Yeah, the song just transformed.
Yeah, it did. There were parts where I was like, how is this going to become a song? But yeah, he's really experimental in the way he records, but also very like, he always lets you know, make your own decisions. So it's cool.
Yeah. And we'll be filming the music video for that hopefully soon as well. With Francis.
Yeah.
El Rosario.
Shout out.
But, we don't have a release date yet, but hopefully in the next few months.
October will be interesting and exciting.
Exciting. And you, of course, have your gig tomorrow night at Moon. Then are there some whispers of a tour coming up after that?
Maybe.
It might have been us whispering.
Okay. Yeah.
We're whispering about the tour.
The whispering is occurring now.
Yeah, we have a North Island tour from the end of October to the start of November. So that's going to be very exciting. That's going to be 6 venues all around the island. We'll be driving in Stella's car. Hopefully the battery doesn't.
As I've got a new battery
now. Yeah, she has a new battery now. So we're going to try to squeeze all of this equipment.
We're going
to
cover it in Milktooth rhinestones.
Yeah. Well. We're going to paint it and make it like a full Milktooth roadie. Yeah.
But also it's a secret. So you can't tell anybody.
Of course. And my final question for you this afternoon, our little sort of ask it forward segment, is something that you as a band like have never been asked, think you should be asked, or would like to know about other musicians. And you don't have to answer the question, next week's guest does. And then I have a question from last week's guest to ask you.
Ask the next band who the first musician who really inspired them was.
Ooh, that's a good one. I like that. Last week, Will McLean, who we had in, asked you, or they wanted to talk about gratitude and things that you carry around with you. So they asked for the top 4 things you're grateful for, but I thought if there's 5 of you, you could each maybe give one thing. And it'd be collaborative gratitude.
I'm grateful for you guys. Oh. Yeah, I'm just grateful that I've... Yeah, maybe that's all of our answers. Yeah, I'm just grateful that we've all just found people that we match with so well.
I'm grateful that, like, I had the privilege to be able to do stuff in the music industry because it's not a very accessible thing. Music is expensive.
Yeah.
And instruments are expensive, so I'm grateful that I am able to do this.
I'm grateful that it's kind of like your one, but I'm grateful that we kind of like get each other. Like, I feel like we are like telepathically inclined when it comes to creating. And I feel like we got really, I feel very lucky to have that.
It's the dynamics between us, I think, that like match, balance each other out so perfectly.
And I love that we all have like the same aim, which is to just create all of the sounds in the world.
Yeah. I'm grateful for the acceptance of different genres that we have in this band as well, and kind of how fearless we are when it comes to exploring different sonic palettes and different sounds. I think that's one of my favorite parts about the band.
Shout.
I can relay it if you
want. I'm grateful for all the, I think the how the community has progressed, and all the different wahine and non-binary folks and trans folks and all different types of folks that have come through, and being able to be, express themselves through their music and their art, and that it's more just like more accepted and more put out there, and it's great, and I'm super happy about it.
Good there. Answer.
Yeah.
I hope everyone could hear that, because that was such a great answer.
Yeah, it's beautiful. It's such a nice note to end on. Would you like to play your last song?
Yes. Yes.
Yay!
Kia ora Milktooth for coming into studio today for this active live session made with New Zealand On Air. You can catch them live Saturday night at Moon, and make sure to check out their new music video tomorrow as well. I've been Amidia Kakite. Thank you so much.
Active Live, Friday, 3:30. Every week a new band, in studio. Brought to you by NZ On Air.